So I'm going to ask you to speculate something based on what you know now about Ibogaine, what you know and don't know about Ibogaine, Ibogaine treatment, TBI, et cetera. You know, could you speculate on what the potential efficacy might be for smaller, long duration administration of Ibogaine for TBI? Of course, I'm talking about microdosing here. Like, yeah. I do understand that there's some relationship to the neurotrophic effects between the immediate action of Ibogaine and the longer, you know, impact of noribogaine as one of its metabolites and so on and so forth. Maybe that's a part of it, maybe not. But yeah, anything that you'd be able to offer on that.
Yeah, I mean, we just don't, I mean, the big thing is we just don't know because we know even less about that. But I would say that, you know, the French were using low doses of Ibogaine from 1930 to 1966. And while there's not really the data back then is, you know, very scant is like a positive spin on, maybe non-existent on what, what that was. I think it's important to kind of understand that, you know, that drug was around at microdose levels for a time. And the reality is that if people didn't have benefit for doing that, then it wouldn't have been a product. Right. And so, there are plenty of things that, that were offered up as potential cures for various things and probably had a similar sort of placebo effect possibility and didn't stick around for 36 years, but low doses of Ibogaine did. And so as a base case, I'd argue that just the sheer fact that it was around for multiple decades and utilized, suggests there was something there. Now, what beyond that, I can't really talk much about the data, but my suspicion is that's going to be an area that's going to be really studied over the course of the next couple of years, the decade, to really sort that out.
Mm-hmm. Hmm. Yeah, it's very interesting to me. I think explicitly because, you know, if I consume psilocybin, it metabolizes and is like out of my system in a very short amount of time. The metabolites, from what I understand, have little to no sort of ongoing effect. But with ibogaine, noribogaine has several other like clinically relevant effects, and it will build over time because it's fat soluble. It can build up in your neural tissue over time where if you take small amounts every day, eventually you get to the place that you've built up enough noribogaine in your system that might mimic what would have been there after a single flood dose. Now, that's based on what I understand, which is, excuse me, you know, clearly less than the data set that you're working with. But I do find it something unique in the microdosing space that it might have to offer. Mind you, and maybe you could answer this, is, you know, ibogaine still has this cardiac risk. And my assumption is that perhaps, you know, microdosing it over a month long might introduce that risk. It might not. I don't know. Again, I assume we don't have this data.
Yeah, I mean, we don't have a sense that I mean, it's scant, so we don't really know this, but I didn't get the sense that the really low dose ibogaine in the French population, you know, had any, there's nothing in the literature to suggest that had, a cardiac risk that was written down, you know? And so, whether it did or not, I bet you couldn't really know that, but I would think that you'd have some sense that could have been present. Really, a lot of this stuff ends up being, you know, dose related anyways. And that was several orders of magnitude less than a flood dose. And so my suspicion is that I'm not going to sit here and tell you there's no risk, but my suspicion is that there's less risk if you look at the information that we have available to us. But still, again, a lot of work to be done. You know, you're not going to really know that until you do the trials.